Yo, it's Riker.
What is up, you amazing, beautiful people? I hope you're doing well wherever you are at, whatever time of day or night you are watching this video, because in today's video, we are going to be reviewing the new Tier 7 Russian medium tank, the T-4485. It literally just came out yesterday. So if you do end up liking the video, smash the like button, leave a comment if you're favored by the video or anything in general down in the comment section below, subscribe and hit that bell notification so you're always notified when I upload a video. Without further ado, let's get right into the stats of this vehicle. So right away for the survivability, you have 1,166 hit points, just like the Rudy. For the armor, don't really have any armor besides a little bit on the front of the tank, the hull, and the turret. I'll show you more in Armor Inspector later, but the armor, do not rely on it. It's not that good. View range is good. I have had no problems with the view range. You could definitely work with the view range and obviously increase it with the equipment. The concealment, while stationary, while moving, and upon firing while stationary, is all pretty decent for a medium tank. Obviously, it's not god tier, but you can work with it, and it's not too bad. And you have 2,410 damage per minute on this tank with a reload time of 4.98 seconds, which is pretty insane. I love that about this tank. It is so quick firing, and either I like very high alpha guns or quick firing guns. That's mainly the way I like to go. I love damage per minute. For the average penetration, for the AP, it is 154, for APCR 220, and for high explosive 47. Not the best. You're going to struggle with the AP when you come up against tier 8 heavy tanks, like the Object 252U, for example. That is going to be pretty hard to pen just with the standard ammunition, unless you know the weak spots of the tank. Mainly going to have to rely on the APCR for that, but overall, personally, I have not had too much of a trouble with it. There have been times where I wished this tank did have more penetration, so you guys will have to work with that. Obviously, you could increase it in the equipment slot, which I did. I added the calibrated shells just to be able to pin more tanks more effectively. And for the average damage for AP, you have 200. For APCR, you have 116. For high explosive, 300. Overall, very good. And this is a quick firing tank, as you guys saw with the reload time and the damage per minute. You could track the enemy in place and allow your team to get shots on them, or you could just dish out the damage if the enemy is just stuck out in the open. For the aiming time, it is 3.2 seconds. Overall, very good. I have not had a problem with it at all. And for the dispersion, it is pretty good. I have not had a problem with that either. And for the gun turn limit, for the elevation, you will have 20, and you guys will see in one of the replays how insane the gun elevation is. I did not even realize that until I actually played the tank in the gameplay. And your gun depression is 6, not too good, but that's to be expected from a Russian tank, pretty much. And for the maneuverability, top speed going forward is 52, reverse 20, and average speed 38. And as you look at these stats, just skim through them right now. Hull turn rate, the turret turn rate, terrain crossing capacity on the road is 123%, on ground 110, and in water 79, and engine power is 747. Overall, this tank is highly mobile and it is very fast and very effective. So that pretty much makes up for the lack of armor, in my opinion. And for the equipment, I am running calibrated shells because earlier in the stats you guys saw, and right there, that the tank's penetration is not that good. So I'd rather have more penetration than damage per minute on this tank. And for the second one, I went for defense systems because I just want everything to be more durable and able to take more of a hit instead of just instantly going down. And for this one, I choose improved optics over the camo net, just to get that extra view range, because you are mainly going to use this tank to spot for your teammates and just see where the enemy's at, just right at the start of the game or when your team needs you to spot. For the next one, I chose enhanced gun laying drive. I don't really feel like supercharge is needed on this tank, and I'd rather have that aiming time increase so I could just snap shots off quicker. And for the next one, I chose improved assembly, just to get the extra hit points so I could take more damage, because enhanced armor, you already have no armor on the tank. You guys could try running it, but I do not recommend it since there's really no armor on this tank besides the turret. So yeah, go for improved assembly on this. For the next one, I chose engine accelerator because I'd rather be mobile and a little bit of everything instead of just the hull turn rate. And the hull turn rate is already very good on this tank. You do not need the improved control, in my opinion, so go for engine accelerator. For the next one, I chose vertical stabilizer, like I said, for the one above it. Rather just have that aiming time, able to snap shots off quicker, and I don't really feel like refined gun is needed on this tank too much. For the next one, I just went for toolbox because I'd rather have the module repair speed instead of the enhanced tracks. I don't really see a point in running enhanced tracks too much. You guys might have a different opinion, but I mainly run toolbox on almost every single tank. And same for high-end consumables. I'd rather have my consumables last longer instead of this one, where the consumables speed is faster. I'd rather have the adrenaline rush and the speed boost last a little bit longer so I could get that extra shot off, or I could reach the spot faster before the enemy can. And for the provisions, I chose the extra combat rations, the condensed milk, and the improved fuel, mainly because I'd rather have a little bit of everything increased along with the reload time and aiming time and all that. Just everything a little increased with these rations. Same for this one. Pretty much the same thing, just get a little boost in those two. And improved fuel to like get mobile and a little bit of everything. The average speed, power to weight ratio, turret turn rate, hull turn rate, and engine power. And for the consumables, I chose the multi-purpose restoration pack. It's pretty self-explanatory. Who isn't running it? Like, if you aren't running it, you definitely need to run it. And I am running the adrenaline and the engine power boost. Like I said, adrenaline just gets shots off faster when I need to in certain situations, or if I just want to get the damage out quicker. And for engine power boost, beat enemies to locations faster, like to bases, capping them out quicker, and also for circle deathing tanks. And then for the ammunition, I am running 35 AP, 6 APCR, and 10 high explosive. The only thing that I might change on this tank later on is taking 2 away from the AP and adding 2 more to HE, and then taking another 2 away from AP and adding 2 more to the APCR, because like I said, this tank does not have that good of penetration. And just to have that those 8 rounds for situations where I really need it, when I'm going up against tier 8 heavy tanks that I cannot pin at all, and it's a 1v1 situation, or just a shot that I need to take and confirm that the tank is out of the game instead of risking a bounce with AP. And for high explosive, just mainly get those high damage shots off when I am behind an enemy tank, or when I come in contact with a very squishy tank like a Hellcat or something like that. And obviously I am running the Bravery camo, as you can see right here. It is very gorgeous in my opinion. Just look at this tank. I'm going to do a 360 real quick. Just look at it. Just looks so good in my opinion. And I really love the look of this tank and the camo, that it's more realistic, like what they would actually use back then, instead of some outlandish bright colors camo. We are going to hop into Armor Inspector right now, and I will show you guys what I was talking about the weak armor, the strong turret armor, and all that. All right, we are in Armor Inspector, and right away you guys could see that everything is pretty much pinnable except for this purple and sometimes the orange part of the turret, but mainly the purple one. As you can see, it's 251 millimeters of armor. So if anybody, right there, 359 millimeters, not many people are going to be able to pin this gun mantlet at all. So use that to your advantage. You mainly want to play in a haul down position, wiggling the turret, because you can get bounces on the turret. And I have noticed if you angle the armor enough, you could get some troll bounces on the front, and if you just wiggle, you could get some troll bounces in general. And obviously you will get some lucky bounces in this tank, like every tank. But as you can see, this front armor not really going to hold up in tier 8 matches. Maybe tier 6 a little bit, and tier 7 stretching it. Like I said, you mainly want to try to angle that or wiggle it. And like I've been saying, this purple part and the gun are mainly your best chances of bouncing anything in this tank. Let's go ahead and look at the sides of the turret. 90, 93. Look at the back. It is 75, 77. This side, 90, 91. And not to mention, the cupola is also another weak point. But let's go look at the sides of the hull. 75, 75. The rear, 45, 56. And just 75, 77. Just look at that. It's so squishy. And almost everybody is going to be able to pin you. So how do you want to play this tank? You mainly want to get into positions right at the start of the battle where you can spot the enemy team and see where they are going, how many of them are on that side, and you can guess how many of them are going on the other side. And look at the lineups. Obviously, you're going to be pushing the medium and light tank side most of the time, unless your entire team decides to push the heavy way. And you don't really want to be frontline or brawling with this tank. You want to stay back a little bit. You can use this as some cover in a gun depression situation, just a little bit, not really much. If you do need more gun depression, you can always drive up on a hill, get that gun down, and get shots off. But I will demonstrate this more in the replays that we have, so let's go ahead and check those out. The tank that I could compare this to the most is not the T-44 at tier 8, it is going to be the T-34 85 Rudy, the tier 7 Russian medium tank, just like this one. Very identical and very similar. The only difference is I would say this tank is a little bit lower, so that gives it a bonus. It is a lower target and harder to hit. But if you guys do know how to play the Rudy at all, or how to play it, you own it, this is pretty much like that, and you guys should know how to play it effectively. But right off the bat, I did go over to that spotting position, drove across base B, and spotted those three enemy tanks. And I noticed that my T-54 E2 is pushing up on base A, capping it out, and there's the T-20. So I decided to help him out, and I hesitated at first on pulling out because there could have been a TD over at the enemy pillbox. But I noticed the T-54 E2 was not getting hit at all, so I figured nobody was there. And this gun elevation right here, the 20 degrees, I could literally just aim straight up and hit that annihilator like it's nothing. Get a shot into him, get a second one, and hit team is able to take him out. That gun elevation does come in handy in situations like that. You can just aim straight up and hit him. I do decide to push up. There's the T-20. I take a shot, however, it does ricochet, which is such a bummer. But I notice that the STA-1 is pushing down. I get hit by the T-20. He's not focusing me, but I decide to focus the STA-1 since my T-54 E2, and it looks like the RHM is pulling up to help us out. And I decide to come back here, take cover behind this annihilator, and use my T-54 E2 as cover, and so we can get more guns on the STA-1. But instead of helping them push up, I noticed that the Tiger II is behind us, so I decided to turn around and help out our Sturmel and the T-49, my bad. Get a shot into the Tiger II, track him in place, but he does repair it. And I cannot pin him out right now, so I switch to APCR and hit him as soon as the side turns. And I hope that helped out the T-49 and those guys over there a little bit. But I noticed the T-20, I track him in place, and this is what I was talking about earlier, about tracking enemies in place and being able to just destroy them if they are out in the open, as demonstrated in this. You could just perma-track people. Literally, as soon as he got the track repaired, I tracked him back in place, and I keep hitting that track, just keeping him stuck there, and I am just shredding him, just absolutely destroying him, and there we go, we take him out of the game. There's the Tiger II. I believe he was chasing one of our friendly tanks, but I take a shot, get his attention, and I decide not to go ahead and rush him since I'm pretty much two shot, maybe a one shot if he gets a high roll. And I was going to try to help out our team, take out the ISU, but there we go, they take him out. So I turn around and focus this Tiger II. I do drop down since the E5 does have Tiger II's attention, and I could get multiple shots in from behind him. There we go, one shot. I'm surprised that didn't bounce. I guess he just moved perfectly in time for me to penetrate him. There's the second one, and can we take him out of the game? He's one shot. There we go, we take him out of the game, doing just over 3,100 damage. And obviously, we do get the win. But there we go, we get the mastery, 3,100 damage. Very good credits. This tank is a very good credit maker, as long as you are not spamming premium ammunition. Two tanks destroyed, and we are on top of the leaderboard for this one. So that game right there did show you guys how to effectively spot right off the bat, use the tank's mobility to get in those spotting positions, spot the enemy, and as you saw, we could get some bounces with this tank, not too many, but some with the gun mantlet, and if you wiggle, and just using the speed, the accuracy, and the DPM, like on that T-20 when we perma-tracked him and just kept him there, and we just destroyed him because he could not move at all. Also, I do not believe this tank is OP. It is not OP at all. It is so squishy, and if you do not know how to play it, it will instantly just get deleted. But right away for this battle, I do pull up into this spot position. As you can see, I'm pretty much the same speed as the MT-25. I did slow down to stop, though. And right here, the view range is going to show how far it goes. As you can see, I do not have a problem with the view range as I spotted the FV and the M6. Try to get a shot there, but he pulled back, so I focus the M6. And I am spotted. Try to get one more shot off before I go, and there we go. We get a bounce from the Rudolph. Keeping an eye on him, making sure he is not pushing me at all. He is getting hit by our team, though. We do get hit by a TD over in that TD spot on the hill back there, if you guys know what I'm talking about, and we get multiple bounces, but I do get one more shot off on that FV, and I pull back to cover, waiting for my camo to reset and seeing if I could get any more shots off, but the enemy is now capping base D, and I'm paying more attention over to my left-hand side, and I see that my MT-25 is pushing up on the Hellcat and the Rudolph, and I know he is going to need my help, because if I do not, he's going to get deleted, and I decide to focus the Rudolph since he is the lowest HP tank. I ignore the Hellcat until I do lower him down, and he is out of my line of sight, and now I start focusing the Hellcat. I should have pushed the Rudolph right there to help out our MT-25. If I did, I could have taken him out and saved our MT-25. Unfortunately, we do not, and I load HE and hit the Hellcat, and then I switch back to AP and take him out of the game. Rudolph is a definite one-shot, so I try to push up, but our M6 takes him out. And there's the Cromwell. I thought I was done for, because he was pretty much full HP, and as you see, I only have 300 HP. But luckily, our team did hit him, set him on fire, and we do get a lucky bounce, or a couple lucky bounces, and take him out of the game. As you can see, this tank is very effective, and you can get some lucky bounces with that turret, and if you wiggle. There's the enemy M6. I was getting a little greedy, trying to just get a shot in on him, but I get hit by that TD who is still over there on the hill. So I decide, screw it, it's not worth it if I get deleted from the game, because I am now a definite one-shot. So I go down in base D, start capping it out, and switch to APCR, because I know the M6 is going to try to push me and take me out of the game. There we go, we cap it out, and as soon as we cap it out, he is spotted. So I decide to turn back around and just wait for him to come into me. I take a shot, and I thought I was the one who destroyed him right there, but the KV-2 was the one who actually ended up taking him out. And then the AT-7 takes out the KV-2. And the AT-7 is still full HP, which is very good, because I could just sit here and farm him. And you guys could see another demonstration of just shredding the tank that is stuck out in the open. He is tracked in place. Get another shot into him. I believe I get one more shot before he decides to back up. Teammates do lower him down to a possible one shot, if not a two shot. And I decide to push up, aim in. I take a shot, it bounces, but luckily he misses his shot. I aim in again, zoom out into third person, and I take him out doing the rest of the 220 damage. For a second, I thought I was going to low roll, but we do end up getting the win. First class, 3,200 damage, good credits, and three tanks destroyed. And that battle showed you guys the mobility of this tank, getting into the spotting positions, and that you can get bounces in this tank if you wiggle or angle at all and use that gun manly. And also, again, with the AT-7, just the DPM of this tank just shredding him. And luckily, I did not get deleted at all. And also, we are on top of the leaderboard for this battle, and we do have one more replay for you guys. In this battle, we should have lost so many times in this battle, but somehow we managed to win, spoiler alert. But you guys will have to see how insane and lucky and how just effective this team was. But right away, instead of actually going up on that hill and spotting the enemy team, for some reason I decided to go over here, and we do end up spotting two tanks. I thought I could possibly go haul down and use this gun manly very effectively and just get some bounces and put out the damage, but the other T-49 on the enemy team does end up nailing me, so I decide, screw it, this is not worth it. Back up, get hit by the E-3 also, and within the first 30 seconds of the game, I'm lowered down to less than half my hit points, and that is not good. Now I have to try to not get hit at all, play super effective, and I still want to play aggressive and get the damage in, so I have to play smart. Push up, and as soon as that T-49 fires, I poke out, get a shot into him. I poke out, knowing there was a risk getting hit by the Scorpion, but I get a shot into him, pull out again, but I see the T-49. Then he goes back to cover, and I shoot the Scorpion instead, getting another shot into him. And now I decide to kind of inch my way into base C, see if I could cap it out, while keeping an eye on those enemy teams and being super cautious on if they are going to poke out and get shots into me. And there we go, our team takes out the enemy T-49. Keeping an eye, the E3 looks like he's moving. I'm almost capped out, but he pulls out, so I decide to start pulling back in cover, track him, place, and hit him. And there is the enemy IS-6 pushing up on us. Instead of pulling out, getting another shot in, I decide to use our Panther 2 and Nova as cover to back up and reposition. And the E3 is going to pull out. I manage to get a shot into him, and he's going to get deleted from the game. But our Lova does get hit from behind, and I go and check, and it is the Chieftain. And I make sure if he has shots on me or not, and he does. So I decide to quickly move out of the way, reposition, and help our AT and T-49 push the Scorpion G and take him out of the game since we are being flanked. There we go, switch AT, take him out. And I kind of did steal that kill from the T-49. I did feel a little bad, but I wanted to get him out of the game before he got a shot into me, him, or the AT. And instead of pushing forward, I decide to turn around and help our team, stopping this enemy flank. And there is the T-25T. He backs up, get a shot into him, damaging his gun. And I decide to stay here a little bit, see if he pokes out again, and see if I can get more shots into him while keeping an eye on the minimap and the enemy team. After a little bit, I decide he's not going to push out, so I decide to push up to where our Panther 2 is, see if we can get shots in. T-25-2 is moving, but I cannot get shots into him. He goes over the hill, and our Lova is taken out of the game. At this point in the game, I realize the enemy has two bases captured, and they are winning by far on the cap points, and I realize we have to start pushing the enemy. We have to be super aggressive now and start taking out the enemy. So I told the team to attack the T-49. There's the T-25, but I figured our T-49 already in the city can take him out. I push up, see if I can get shots, but the gun depression is failing me. And I pull back in time so the IS-6 does not get a shot into us. Switch to APCR, try to get a shot off, does not quite make it. And I know I don't have gun depression, so I drive up on the hill to lower my gun and get a shot into that T-49, taking him out of the game. And at some point, our T-49 took out the T-25, but the enemy is so close to winning on cap points. So I let the team know I am pushing base B to cap it out, and I let the T-49 know he needs to get into base A, and I'm just hoping he gets there in time and caps it out. He starts capping out, and I start capping on base B, and our team takes out the IS-6, which is very good, and we stop the enemy from getting points and winning that way. And right now, it's looking good. It looks like we are going to win, but then the Chieftain starts capping out base C. And I'm figuring, oh, he's probably low HP. We could probably get there in time. So I'm telling the team to attack and push. But he is almost full HP. And most of our team is low hit points, except for the Panther 2 and AT, I believe. So instead of just full-on bum rushing that start, that entrance over there, I decide to go around, flank around, and surprise him from the side. And I'm letting my team know we have to attack now, or we are going to lose no matter what. Me and the T-49 are both two shots to him. And I rush into the base along with the T-49. He gets a hit into me. I am now two-shot, possible one-shot for him, and the T-49 is a definite one-shot for him. So I decide to put myself between him and the Chieftain just to body block and take a hit for the T-49. Now we are both one-shots, so I have to rely on this gun's DPM along with the Panther 2s, get shots into him, and he's almost reloaded, about to take a shot, but the Panther 2 ends up taking him out of the games, and somehow we managed to win that. That was really insane, and at the time, my hands were shaking, my heart was pumping. But we get the mastery, 2,700 damage, very good credits, and two tanks destroyed, and we are on top of the leaderboard for that battle. And that battle really showed you guys how to use this tank's mobility, how to effectively play this tank, and how to smartly play this tank, and also be super aggressive in it at the same time, and also showed you guys the DPM of this tank when, at the end, I had to rely on it to take out that Chieftain before he could take any of us out, and we lose the battle. But do I think this tank is worth it? Yes, I do think this tank is worth it, but not right now. Because right now, it is in the lock boxes, and that is gambling. It's a 50-50 on if you are even able to get the tank. So definitely do not waste your money on that. When it does come on sale later on for money or for gold, go ahead and get it. My price range for it would be the max for gold around 8,000, and that's kind of stretching it. But if it's any lower, go ahead and jump on it. And for money, probably $12-15-ish, something around there is probably the max I would go if I was wanting this tank and not wanting to waste my money on the lock boxes or any crates for the gambling. But that does it for the review of this tank. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I hope to help you out in some way on how to play the tank and if you guys do think this tank is good or worth it. And I will be doing a guide / how to play more in depth and using more games that I feel like would better demonstrate how to play the tank if you do have this tank and you are wondering how to play it. Later on, probably tomorrow or in a couple days, I will be uploading that video. But if you did like the video, go ahead and smash that like button and leave a comment of what you think about this tank, if you think it's OP, if you think it's not OP, and just your general thoughts on it, and if you do think it's worth it for the lock boxes, or if you should just wait on it later on for when it does come on sale for money or gold. Also, subscribe and hit that bell notification so you're always notified when I upload a new video. With that being said, I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you in the next one. How does it feel to breathe when you're dead? They've never seen you out of your bed.